All right, everybody, good morning. I'm Gary Hall. I'm the Dean of the Washington National Cathedral, and on behalf of Mary Ann Edgar Buddy, the Bishop of Washington, and Katharine Jefferts Schori, the presiding bishop of the Episcopal Church, on behalf of everyone who regularly worships and works and volunteers here, it is my great pleasure to welcome you to the signal event we have every year, the Acolyte Festival. This is one of our most wonderful and important events, and I just want to congratulate you. There are 92 churches represented today. There are 675 acolytes here today. And as a former high school teacher, I want to say that for a teenager to give up a Saturday is really something. We have, coming from the farthest distance, we think this morning, but I'm open to correction, are the folks from Good Samaritan Episcopal Church in Sammamish, Washington. Where are you guys? All right. And here we are by state, Connecticut. Where's Connecticut? All right. The fabulous District of Columbia. Florida. They're here in numbers. Georgia. Aren't there any fans of Georgia out there? Illinois. Indiana. Kentucky, Louisiana, Maryland, my former state of Michigan, North Carolina, Nebraska, New Jersey, New York, my wife's home state of Ohio, Pennsylvania, Tennessee, the great state of Texas, Virginia. They're here in force too. Washington State and West Virginia. And finally, I just want to say that this is not just an Episcopalian thing, but we also have, in addition to Episcopalians, we have people from the African Methodist Episcopal Church, Congregationalists, UCC, Igbo Anglican, Lutheran, and Methodist. Worship is central to the life of the church. It's central to the life of this cathedral, and the ministry of acolytes is central to our ability to do worship with dignity and grace. And so on behalf of everyone, I thank you already for your ministry, and I look forward to a wonderful morning together. Welcome.
Thank you. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be God's kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Bishop Katharine, I present to you these persons who have been called to a ministry of service at the altar of God, and who have come here today to Washington National Cathedral and to this Acolyte Festival to affirm their commitment as acolytes in Christ's Holy Church.
Thank you. Thank you.
Sheep.
friends in Christ, we acknowledge in the name of God the acolytes gathered here today, and we pray that God will richly bless them in their ministry. Dear people of God, you present yourselves here today as those called to serve at the altar of God in your congregations. Do you dedicate yourselves to a life of loving service to God, desire to assist in the leadership of worship, and promise to remain faithful in prayer, service, and praise? Let us pray. Gracious God, will all of you who witness these promises do all in your power to support these young people in their service as acolytes? Ever-living God, bless these acolytes. May they praise your holy name as they serve your people at worship, in the celebration of sacrament, and at prayer. Praise God who made heaven and earth. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Holy God, no one is excluded from your love, and your truth transforms the minds of all who seek you. As your servant Philip was led to embrace the fullness of your salvation and to bring the stranger to baptism, so give us all the grace to be heralds of the gospel, proclaiming your love in Jesus Christ, our Savior, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
A reading from the prophet Isaiah. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. By a perversion of justice, he was taken away. Who could have imagined his future? For he was cut off from the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people. They made his grave with the wicked and his tomb with the rich, although he had done no violence and there was no deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him with pain. When you make his life an offering for sin, he shall see his offspring and shall prolong his days. Through him, the will of the Lord shall prosper. Out of his anguish, he shall see light. He shall find satisfaction through his knowledge. The righteous one, my servant, shall make many righteous and shall bear their iniquities. The word of the Lord.
and bless us. Show us the light of his countenance and come to us. Let your ways be known upon earth, your saving health among all nations.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. An angel of the Lord said to Philip, "Get up and go toward the south to the road that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza. This is a wilderness road." So he got up and went. Now there was an Ethiopian eunuch, a court official of the Candace, queen of the Ethiopians, in charge of her entire treasury. He had come to Jerusalem to worship and was returning home. Seated in his chariot, he was reading the prophet Isaiah. Then the Spirit said to Philip, "Go over to this chariot and join it." So Philip ran up to it and heard him reading the prophet Isaiah. He asked, "Do you understand what you are reading?" He replied, "How can I, unless someone guides me?" And he invited Philip to get in and sit beside him. Now the passage of the scripture that he was reading was this: "Like a sheep, he was led to the slaughter, and like a lamb, silent before its shearer, so he does not open his mouth. In his humiliation, justice was denied him. Who can describe his generation? For his life is taken away from the earth." The eunuch asked Philip, "About whom, may I ask you, does the prophet say this, about himself or about someone else?" Then Philip began to speak, and started with this scripture. He proclaimed to him the good news about Jesus. As they were going along the road, they came to some water, and the eunuch said, "Look, here's water. What is to prevent me from being baptized?" He commanded the chariot to stop, and both of them, Philip and the eunuch, went down into the water, and Philip baptized him. When they came up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord snatched Philip away. The eunuch saw him no more and went on his way rejoicing. But Philip found himself at Azotus, and as he was passing through the region, he proclaimed the good news to all the towns until he came to Caesarea. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
Jesus came and said to the disciples, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always, to the end of the age." The Gospel of the Lord.
Well, good morning. And welcome to all God's beloveds, friends of Jesus gathered in this place. I bring you greetings from across the Episcopal Church, from Episcopalians in Taiwan, in Micronesia, in Honduras, Ecuador, Colombia, Venezuela, Curacao, Haiti, the Dominican Republic, the British and US Virgin Islands, Austria, Belgium, France, Germany, Italy, Switzerland, and the many parts of the United States, many of whom are represented here this morning. They pray for you. I would ask your prayers for them. Have you ever had something go wrong during worship? I'm sure it never happens in your place. The day after I was ordained a deacon, the bishop came for a visitation. It was my job to read the gospel. We took the gospel book down the aisle, opened it, and I started to read the Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. I quickly realized that something was wrong, but I wasn't sure what. Then a parishioner came up behind me and whispered, "That's last week's gospel." Whoops. So I turned the page and went on, a continuation of the gospel according to St. John. Afterward, the parish deacon said to me, "Every week I make a mistake. By the end of my life, I may have made them all." We're celebrating the Feast of Philip today. Jesus called Philip to be one of his disciples about the same time that he called Andrew and Simon Peter. Philip appears several times in the Gospels. Once, when they met a big crowd, more even than would fit in this cathedral, Jesus asked Philip how they were going to feed them all. And Philip said, "Well, even 6 months' wages wouldn't be enough to feed this bunch." But a boy's lunch was blessed and became enough for all of them. Later, when Jesus went to Jerusalem for the Passover, and the events that we remember during Holy Week, some Greek visitors came up to Philip to ask for a meeting with Jesus. So Philip and Andrew went off to find Jesus, and when he hears what they want, Jesus responds by telling them that he's going to die, and that if they want to find their lives, they're going to have to lose them. And a couple days later, when Jesus has his final supper with the disciples, Philip asks Jesus to see the Father. And Jesus reminds him that they've been looking at him for quite a while in Jesus, and they should have begun to get some idea of what God is like. After Jesus' death and his resurrection, his followers began to gather in groups smaller than this one to remember, to tell stories, and to eat a blessed and holy meal. Those communities had plenty of poor and hungry people in them, and they began to identify some of their number to ensure that the hungry got fed. Philip was a member of the first group to be named to that ministry. They were called deacons. Deacon means a servant or a minister. And we understand that every baptized person shares that kind of ministry, and acolytes are a remarkable example of it. Most of what we know about Philip is related to feeding people and introducing people to Jesus. That second story we heard today is another example. Philip and another of those deacons named Stephen had been in Jerusalem, where Stephen had been preaching about Jesus. But after a while, Stephen moved from preaching to meddling, as they say. He accuses some of the leaders in the Jerusalem community of being less than faithful. And they respond by dragging him out and stoning him to death. And Philip leaves Jerusalem and goes up north to Samaria. He's been preaching there too, with a little more success. And his community in Jerusalem has sent other people to Samaria to follow up, to make sure that these new converts learn more about Jesus. And then Philip gets a call to go south toward Gaza in the story we heard. He runs across this Ethiopian court official riding along in his chariot, reading from Isaiah. In the ancient world, everybody read out loud, so it was easy for him to recognize what he was reading. It's sort of like seeing the video in the car next to you and running over to talk about it. The Ethiopian has been in Jerusalem to worship at the temple, but because he's a eunuch, he can't be a full member of the Jewish community. He knows about God, but he hasn't met anybody who will invite him into a deeper relationship. There's Philip's chance to teach somebody what he has learned from Jesus when he asked Jesus to show us God. The eunuch asks Philip who the prophet is writing about. And we have to believe that he has heard the prophet's words as a description of himself and his condition. Philip begins to tell the eunuch good news about Jesus, about the friendship that he offers to those who follow him, and the ways that he proclaims liberty to people who are shut up in prison, and freedom to anybody who feels enslaved or oppressed or unfree. You know, those two people back on that, my first Sunday as a deacon, did that for me. It was a very minor thing, but they did it. We can all do that kind of work. Everybody here can be a Philip or a Philippa, feeding their neighbors and telling them or showing them good news. That's what being an acolyte's all about. Being a friend of Jesus who can show the people around you what Jesus and therefore God is like. He was a friend to anybody who needed one. Now, if you look around today, you have a remarkable opportunity here to make friends with people from another part of the country or a different church. I assume we all know something about Jesus, but we never know all we need to know about Jesus. When you're on your way home after this morning and this afternoon, I'd encourage you to talk about the person you shared lunch with and what that person showed you about Jesus. You've got a lot of opportunity in the next few hours. Philip made a friend with somebody who wasn't welcome at a whole lot of dinner tables or even in church. Have you ever done that? Made a friend with somebody who needed to find a place to be at home? The way that you serve as an acolyte can be an invitation to come closer and become a friend. Or it's possible that it could be a real turnoff. I don't know. Do you think that your ministry as an acolyte is joyful enough to invite somebody else to meet Jesus? Or is it a dismal burden? If you don't find any joy, then I'd suggest that you go looking for another way to be a friend of Jesus's. There isn't just one way to show people what God is like, but all those ways have to show something about the love that God has for us. I know it's not easy to get up early in the morning when you're serving, and it can be challenging to learn all the different ways that worship is done, and believe me, it's different in every congregation. But it has to show other people that it's good to be a friend of Jesus and not a drag. Those two people who reached out to me that Sunday morning showed me that even when we get it wrong, we still have friends in Jesus's community. When Jesus says to his friends that they're supposed to go and make disciples everywhere and baptize them and teach them what he has taught them, that's what he means. Go and make friends like the friend he has been to them. Somebody who loves and forgives and encourages and sets free. That is a privilege and a joy, and there are a whole lot of different ways to do it, including swinging thuribles and lighting candles and herding cats. Don't ever take yourselves too seriously. We are supposed to do our best. We're supposed to remember that we're forgiven even before we ask. And we're supposed to remember that we will never get it perfect until the second coming, until Jesus comes back. And at that point, it won't matter. So remember to find joy in what you're doing. God loves you. Show the world God loves you. Jesus is your friend. Jesus is your homie. Go find some more. Discover new friends here and new skills, and let the world see your joy. Shout it out. Jesus is my friend. Let me be your friend too. Jesus is my friend. Let me be your friend too.
As the church gathered from many places, let us pray with one voice for the whole people of God, made one in Christ Jesus, to love and serve the world, and enlivened by the Holy Spirit for ministry and mission. God of all faithfulness,
we lift our prayers to you.
Summon your church beyond comfortable witness to urgent proclamation of the gospel of forgiveness and welcome. Make us nimble in ministry and mission, following the example of Christ. God of all faithfulness,
we lift our prayers to you.
Order the common life of all nations by the currency of your reign, that all who govern may demonstrate an abiding commitment to the welfare of all people. God of all faithfulness,
we lift our prayers to you.
Bless all who embrace with joy the care of your creation, which proclaims your greatness, shows forth your praise, inspires our worship. God of all faithfulness,
we lift our prayers to you.
Sustain your people in their distress, the despairing and the anxious, those consumed by greed and those strangled by poverty, those with invisible wounds whose suffering only you know. God of all faithfulness,
we lift our prayers to you.
Be present with the dying and inspire us to live as confidently as those who have died in faith. God of all faithfulness,
we lift our prayers to you.
Keep strong in faith and witness all who care for vessels and vestments, scripture and sacrament, beauty and order in support of the worship of your people. Send your blessing upon these acolytes gathered here today out of love for you, who delight in your worship. God of all faithfulness,
we lift our prayers to you.
We long to hear you speak, O God, and you send Jesus, your incarnate word, calling us to a costly and complete obedience. Lay your hands upon us. Give our lives the cruciform shape of faithfulness, that we may neither fear nor flinch in following Jesus, our Savior and our Lord.
Amen.
Through Christ, God has put away our sin and made us blameless before the throne of grace. The peace of Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
Since you're all following the presiding bishop's instructions, I'm a little loath to put a stop to the peace, but I think, given your schedule, it would be good to go on. Welcome once again to Washington National Cathedral. The only other thing I have to say by word of welcome is to explain the way we do communion here. We have stations around the nave. You'll be guided towards those stations. Everyone who is here is welcome at God's table to receive the bread and wine of communion. If you would rather receive a blessing than take communion, please let us know that by folding your arms across your chest. This is a wonderful event, and this event is made possible by the generosity and faithfulness of so many people in our life. God has been so generous to us in so many ways, and we ask that you now respond to God's generosity by giving to support the mission and the ministry of God through this cathedral that makes this yearly festival possible. So let us with gladness present the offerings and the oblations of our life and our labor to God.
be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
All thanks and praise are yours at all times and in all places, our true and loving God. Through Jesus Christ, your eternal word, the wisdom from on high, by whom you created all things. You laid the foundations of the world and enclosed the sea when it burst out from the womb. You brought forth all creatures of the earth and gave breath to humankind. Wondrous are you, Holy One of blessing. All you create is a sign of hope for our journey. And so as the morning stars sing your praises, we join the heavenly beings and all creation as we shout with joy. Creator of all. Your word has never been silent. You called a people to yourself as a light to the nations. You delivered them from bondage and led them to a land of promise. Of your grace, you gave Jesus to be human, to share our life, to proclaim the coming of your holy reign, and give himself for us a fragrant offering. Through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, you have freed us from sin, brought us into your life, reconciled us to you, and restored us to the glory you intend for us. We thank you that on the night before he died for us, Jesus took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it, gave it to his friends, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, Jesus took the cup of wine, said the blessing, gave it to his friends, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." And so, remembering all that was done for us, the cross, the tomb, the resurrection and ascension, longing for Christ's coming in glory, and presenting to you these gifts your earth has formed and human hands have made, we acclaim you, O Christ.
Dying, you destroyed our death. Rising, you restored our life. Christ Jesus, come in glory.
Send your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these gifts of bread and wine, that they may be to us the body and blood of your Christ. Grant that we, burning with your Spirit's power, may be a people of hope, justice, and love. Giver of life, draw us together in the body of Christ, and in the fullness of time, gather us with all your people into the joy of our true eternal home. through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, we worship you, our God and Creator, in voices of unending praise. Blessed are you, now and forever. Amen. As we join our prayers with those of the Church Universal, so we say, each in our own language, the prayer that Jesus Christ has taught us. Padre nuestro, que estás en el cielo, santificado sea tu nombre. Venga tu reino, hágase tu voluntad, en la tierra como en el cielo. Danos hoy nuestro pan de cada día. Perdona nuestras ofensas, como también nosotros perdonamos a los que nos ofenden. No nos dejes caer en tentación y líbranos del mal. Porque tú eres el reino, tú eres el poder y tú eres la gloria, ahora y por siempre. The gifts of God for the people of God. Let us pray. Holy and blessed God, you have fed us with the body and blood of your Son, and filled us with your Holy Spirit. May we honor you not only with our lips, but in lives dedicated to the service of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, keep you and preserve you this day and forevermore.